Welcome to the Wired In Podcast. I be the Curse and my co-host,
Young Stalin.
Today we have a very special guest. Sir, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Rude Boy D-Lo, man. What's happening?
Mr. No-Honest motherfucker, bitch.
Yourself. You here.
Appreciate you coming through.
Hide your hoes, niggas. Hide your hoes, bitches. Paint your toes. Pimps, hide your hoes.
You heard what he said. And you got access satisfaction, baby.
Period.
So, glad you just started.
So, yeah, man. I wanted to get into it. We finna jump. I've been knowing D-Lo for hella years, man. This like my little brother. So, I love this nigga to death. And I know everything about this nigga past. So, nigga, we finna jump straight into the future. So, I remember I was talking to you just before you, you caught a whole nother case on me. I remember you was talking to me. You was fighting one case. I'm like, blood, what happened? You like, I was sitting in the car and sack in front of the bitch house, and they got behind me, and I got off on them. Like, blood, you was a fucking rap star, blood. What makes you want to steal high speed chase, blood?
Nigga, I was fresh out.
Like, I ain't going back up.
Yeah, I was fresh out, nigga. Like, you feel me? I had my shit on me, and I was like, come on, D-Lo, bro. I'm like, no, this ain't happening right here.
Like, not right now.
And I was just like, man, I ain't going back. I'm finna try not to go back right now. So that's when I pulled off. You feel me? And yeah, she got ugly.
So how long were you done?
2 years. Some change. You feel me?
Have you noticed anything major that's different since before you went in? Because you know shit moves
like
so fast.
World?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, hella shit different. Shit hella more expensive. I went grocery shopping and couldn't believe.
An apple, they want $4 for an apple.
Bro. No, for real, bro. I think I seen like the little regular little 12 slice of Kraft cheese, and that shit was like, nigga, $6 or some shit. I was like, bro, y'all playing.
That shit be 99.
Bro, everything's hella expensive. The gas killed me though.
The gas.
Bro, when I'm out and about, I spend like $200 in a day on gas, bro. I promise.
No, for real.
Like that shit disrespectful, bro.
Damn.
Yeah, I went to jail, gas was like four something. Yeah. Shit went up a whole $3.
Yeah.
So I remember when No-Ho first hit, and it was the biggest song in the Bay. How was you feeling at that moment?
It was kind of unbelievable, you feel me? And it was just like, damn. Because I was fresh rapping, you feel me? And for it to happen like that, like, you know, happen like that. You know what I mean? I literally had like some, over a few nights, success. You feel
that was
me?
Like one of, that was like one of the nigga first songs you recorded.
Off, I just felt weird. It was like, damn, bro, they really like this motherfucking song. Like, I felt like I was somebody already, like somebody. I'm like, man, I'm finna be up there with them, you feel me?
With the ones,
like, they love me. And then, you know, as time went on, you know, I adjusted to it more because I started seeing the real life part of that shit. So I was like, man, it felt good, you feel me? Like, nigga, coming from where we come from, it's like, nigga.
How does it feel nowadays, like when you go to Summer Jam and shit like that, and it still rings out and you still see the crowd?
That's still the biggest song in the
band. Yeah, like,
I expect that. I ain't gonna lie, I expect that, like, especially in an arena.
Yeah.
I got higher expectations when it's in the arena. Okay. Like, nigga, it's 15,000, 20,000 people. You motherfuckers better go crazy.
Word for word.
Y'all better, like, come on, man. I expect that. Other shit, I don't.
What was the motivation behind that song? Like, did you get into it with a hoe and you was like, bitch, I don't give a fuck about you. Like, bitch, I'm gonna make a song. Do you think I'm playing, bitch?
It was just like,
cause that song is hella real. Like, that ain't no, like, I know I can hear fictitious niggas raps when I hear it.
Yeah, see, back then, nigga, I really, no, cause back then I really was just, I was young, so nigga, I was a teenager still, so I really was on some nigga, I'm gonna fuck a bitch, and after that, bitch, I don't call you no more. I was one of them for real, like, I didn't care, like in high school, in junior high, I didn't have girlfriends, bro, yeah. Like, I didn't have no, like you said earlier, nigga, I didn't have high school sweethearts, nigga, I was the nigga who was just trying to, you feel me, blab something and get on by my business, and that just turned into getting into it with bitches, and bitch, fuck you, like, nigga, people tell me it's because I grew up without a mama. I grew up, nigga, without a mama, so I was around them with niggas. And I seen a lot of shit when it come to relationships and all that, and how shit I was around was different. You feel me? So, I don't know. I guess all that grew on me or whatever. But, I mean, I care. I don't get it fucked up.
Right.
Nigga just ain't no hardcore ass, fuck all these bitches. No.
So, who was you raised by? Granny?
I was raised by my grandparents, my granny and my granddad. Pops was there, but he, you know, he was in and out of jail, hella much and all that type of shit. But when he wasn't there, you feel me, he was there. You feel me? So, but, yeah.
I know you from the, I know you from the 80s, so that's where you was raised with your granny in the 80s?
Nah, actually, my granny didn't live on 91st. 91st. Digitally, so that's where the nigga originally lived.
Okay, yeah.
But, you know.
My little cousin from 89 from D Street. I mean, 98 D Street. Shout out to my little cousin Maybach.
You know how she go. You jump off the porch and you learn everything. You learn that, nigga, that's what I read. You feel me? So.
I remember, allegedly, when I was a little nigga, I remember hearing stories about the Burnout family having walkie-talkies and shit.
Yeah, oh, man, that shit was crazy. That
you feel me? Like,
that was some real TV shit, bro. That was some, oh, because they had, like, a machine, nigga.
No, for real, yeah.
Couldn't go sell your own sack there, but the machine was crazy.
Allegedly.
Yeah, allegedly. The machine was really crazy. Like, like seven jobs.
Tell the people something about Oakland that you can't find or experience anywhere else.
I mean, our culture alone. You know, our old school culture. Not old school, but well, you get what I'm saying. Like, our culture is different. Like, it's cities and places that's close by this motherfucker that still ain't. Our culture.
Totally different?
Yeah, it's just totally different. You won't see this nowhere, bro. Like, I done been in hella places, man. I've been in hella different hoods in different states, all that. We just got some, it's some real different shit about us, bro. That's, it's just different.
It, to me, Oakland feels like real soulful. Like, people give a shit about Oakland. And you don't really see that a lot of different places. People from Oakland have a love for Oakland that you could just feel it, like, being from somewhere else, that's what I know.
This new generation don't know about the old Oakland at all.
Yeah.
And we caught the end of
the end of the our end real
of,
culture.
Yeah, of our real culture, you feel me? So it's just I know our history. You feel me? I got a lot of OGs and uncles and cousins and you feel me? And
the principles and the shit that we grew up on as young men in Oakland, those aren't the principles that they're living by and standing on now. Like,
and you can't even put it into them.
They don't even understand it.
They wouldn't get it.
I mean, even if they got it, it don't fit in their life, in their lifestyle, or how they live. The shit we came up on don't make sense to them right now. You know me? So,
I know, like, jail be depressing a hella much to artists and shit. So, were you able to write in there? Were you able to be creative in there?
It was hella on and off. I wasn't writing a lot at all. I
mean, you heard the days though?
Nah, I ain't have my days.
See, that's why I said you
trying to play dumb.
Not the jail rapper, bro. Like, yeah. But I do get in my mo. Like, the whole time I was fighting and all that, when I got to the pen, I went to reception. So in reception, if you don't know, you sitting in your cell. You ain't no coming out. You're not for until you leave to go to the big spot. So when I was stuck in that cell for reception, that's when I was writing. Feel me? I'm like, shit, I think I'm gonna be in here for 2 months, nigga. And I start writing right now, man. But my mind don't be there to write.
To be creative.
Yeah, it's like, I can write, but it ain't going to be the best of me.
It's not D-Lo.
Sometimes to be creative, you got to be in the creative space.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Always. And then you got some people, though, who go to jail and make great shit. I'm just not one of them niggas. Like, I'm a on-the-spot nigga for real. I don't write at home. I don't, like, I'm a on-the-spot nigga. I go in the studio and hear the beat, then we do it. I don't write.
I
would say you have two types of rappers. You got beat on the chest and table rappers, and then you got the niggas that don't. I can't do that. But that comes from niggas who be in jail all the time.
Yeah.
All their life.
What? To where all their songs sound like that beating on the chest. It's the same beat. To be that.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of creative music, do you write or do you punch in or do you?
I do both.
You do both?
I do both. It depends. Like, most of the time, I write the first 2-4 bars just to get it started. And I go in the booth and finish the rest. Like, just, you feel me, punching in. But I used to couldn't punch in. Hella years ago, that shit was hard for me.
Yeah.
And then I just got, I told him, that shit really the same as writing.
It is.
The only difference is you're just not writing it down. When you think about it in the booth, If you was out the booth, you would write it down. Yeah. But instead of writing it, you're saying.
I think it's raw shooting because it's the first thing that comes to mind.
It's way faster and easier to do that. You feel me? And then when you write it, if you write a whole 16, you're going to go in there trying to rap the whole thing.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? Yeah. It ain't going to sound like certain songs really sound better with you punching it in because you're going to perfect the words instead of running over
and emphasize certain shit.
Exactly. So, like, it's better to punch in.
And do you prefer to record or perform? Which one do you like more?
I like performing more. I'm going to keep it real. That's the fun part to me.
That's because you've got a big monster-ass hit. Yeah, 15,000 people singing that shit.
Recording, that's like that's part of our job. You have to do that part. Right. You're not going to get paid. Right. You have to record.
So during your career, during your 10-span career, was there ever a time where you went groupie crazy?
Groupies on me?
Yeah, like, I was just doing
my thing, you know? Like, nah,
yeah, that's what I mean, yeah.
Like, he was like, real deal.
What? Nigga, from, I'm gonna say from 2008 to 2012, oh, I went Yankees.
All right, give me a crazy story about a crazy bitch.
Oh, man, so, right, so this one bitch, it's crazy because people know her too. Anyways, she ended up suing me, so look.
God damn!
So, I'm in jail, not this time, another time I was in the PNN, I was talking to this bitch or whatever, boom, when I get out. Mind you, I never met her in person.
Damn.
Never met her in person, so when I get out, I mean, well, I seen her person from her coming to visit me. But physically outside of jail this year. So anyways, when I get out, the day I get out, she gave me $12,000. She gave me her credit card. Like, here, use my credit card and go shopping with me. Boom. I do that. You feel me? I give her a credit card back the same day, and I blow up. You feel me? Like a hoe do.
Never called the bitch again, never answered the phone. Bitch, what you thought, bitch?
And that part right there was cool, I guess. You feel me? Like, she was like, whatever. Now,
where's the problem coming?
The problem came when I did a song called The Truth. And I said her, I didn't say her name, I said her Instagram name. You feel me? And
bitch gave me $12,000, I ran a check and blew up.
That was the bar?
That's exactly how it went. I done got sued already, so I can say shit. What I said was, I said I had this bitch off Instagram named Misfit. She gave me 12 bands and I blew up on that bitch quick.
Period.
Well, I got served like a week after
the
summer came out. And I, was, damn, and I got served at my show.
You serious?
Oh, God.
Damn, she wasn't playing, huh?
Before. I know how that shit go.
Yeah, that shit was me.
She wasn't playing, huh?
So how is it handling rap fame when you in jail? Like, do niggas be like dick ride? Like, do everybody wanna rap battle against you? Do niggas wanna, like, hey, bro, can you write me a rap?
You talking about the people in jail?
Yeah. Oh, they do. That shit crazy. After so long, it died down until you're around new niggas. When some new niggas come in and all that, it start over again.
And everybody wants you to hear that shit.
I've been seeing it. I see it. Niggas that come in and they see me and don't. Either they recognize and be like, is that
nigga? Oh,
or a nigga will tell them. Or somebody will tell them. And he's like, well, you know, people over here. Well, you really? DMS Quest. Let me hear something. Like, what?
Let me hear something? Really?
Let me hear something. You been writing some shit? No. Niggas telling them, though, oh, bro, he don't rap. He don't rap in here. But niggas ask me so much. I wait one night, I get drunk, and I'm like, hey, for everybody that asks me, this y'all chance, right here, boom, on my kids, I was having concerts.
That's dope.
But it'll be once every 5-6 months.
Yeah.
Like, nigga, y'all have to get out of that system.
You didn't get drunk off that Pruno, you're like, know where at? Tell everybody, nigga, 6 o'clock, child high, nigga.
Because everybody drunk, so niggas
child home, nigga, I'm gonna go crazy.
All right, get everybody together, because niggas ain't finna keep asking me every day. You ask me. We gonna do this shit at one time,
God,
and that's it. You feel me?
Oh
That shit get irritating. No, I'm kidding.
That's beautiful.
So, you working on a new album?
Yeah, I've been. I'm just working. I ain't gonna lie, I've been just recording hella shit.
Yeah.
I'm finna do an album for sure. And it's just out of all the shit I'm recording, I'm just, you feel me?
How does it feel to be back in the groove of the mix, doing music again and stuff?
This is what I was waiting for.
Yeah.
I mean, this is what I stressed about doing. This is what I sat in jail like, man, I can't wait to get back to this. I can't wait to get back to my kids. I can't wait to, you feel me? Like, this is what it is.
Man. How's the reception been from your fans since you got released?
It's lovely. I ain't gonna lie, they missed me.
How was it knowing that they were holding you down when you were inside? Because, you know, everybody was very concerned and praying for
you. It was cool. I kind of, like, wasn't really, like, posting on shit like that, like on jail shit. Like, motherfuckers knew I was in jail or missing or whatever the case might be. I wasn't just hella with the free D-Lo hype on there because, nigga, that's always my story.
this nigga started out for real, bro.
That's all in my story. So I'm like, man, you know what? Fuck this. I'm going to just get out and show them instead of just nigga trying to do the free D-Lo this, free D-Lo.
So now that you out and you back working again, but you should have did some free D-Lo t-shirts. So, motherfuckers, when you look down. Gotta keep the merch coming.
For sure.
Got
to. Nigga Stallion always got a dollar on his money.
Period, man. Right,
for sure.
Now that you back out and you working again, like, what's your expectations going forward for your career?
Just to better myself, bro, and just continue to please my fans, bro, and get my dollars off this shit. You feel me? I don't want to be the Jay-Z's, or I just want a nigga finesse it to where, nigga, I can make enough money to where my kids good, like, you feel me? Which is gonna happen regardless, you feel me? But, like, the main goal is to, nigga,
do not sell your catalog. No, as long as you don't sell your catalog,
I ain't never sold a catalog a day in my life. I'm not.
My stupid ass sold one album.
How do you go about not chasing another number?
Don't think about it.
Don't think about it?
Because that was my, when No Ho came out, I was my thing.
Another one, yeah.
I was like, man, I can't be on one hit wonder.
Oh, so you was looking for another one?
What? Fuck looking, nigga. After that, I was like, I'm thinking, I'm like, yeah, nigga, I'm gonna make another one.
No,
nigga,
you are definitely so not a one hit wonder.
It was so hard, though, bro. It was hard. I was like, bro, I can't make another. I was trying.
Bro,
to make
another.
I know, that's what I'm saying. That's
you played me hit hell hard.
Yeah, but that came, I wasn't trying. Oh, Rico came with that. Rico hit me like, oh, I got this hook.
Hey, that motherfucker.
And when he came with the hook, we just.
Yo, listen, when I heard that made everybody say, oh, he ain't a one-hit wonder.
All my life.
Oh, he ain't a one-hit wonder. Like, okay, this nigga got some shit in him, though.
I was like, thank you.
So nowadays, what you do is you just don't even. That's out of your mind. You just let the music lead you somewhere.
I think, on some real shit, I don't even think radio no more, bro. That shit don't. I don't think radio. If it make it on that motherfucker, it do.
We never got love out here for the radio like that to make radio records. Like, if we had a real friendlier relationship with the radio, like, if we knew, like, motherfuckers in Atlanta and New York and these other places, they know for sure, blood, that if they make one song for the radio, that their people are going to play it. Yeah. You feel me? It's a guarantee. The Bay Area never had that guarantee with radio. Like, we've just, you know what I'm saying? Like, I know for a fact that most of the artists that get on in the Bay Area, from the Bay Area, on radio, they sign to a label first and the label does it. It's very rare that it happens independent. It happens, but it's very, very rare. And it's like, when you're independent, like, it'll be, you finna sign to a label. If you didn't, they'll hear that labels are, on it, and then they'll pick it up. But just, a nigga just straight grind, like, you can have the hottest song in the streets and the radio still won't play it. That do not happen in New York, L.A., or Los Angeles. Atlanta.
Right.
That do not happen in New York, Atlanta, or Los Angeles.
Right.
You got the hottest shit in the streets, the radio plays it. Because at the end of the day, you're supposed to be...
for the people.
Doing it for the consumers.
Right.
You feel me? You're supposed to be trying to please the consumers.
Exactly.
The customers are always right. So you have to follow their lead. What they listen to, that's what you play, because those are the motherfuckers that's listening to your station, that's giving you the views to have advertising money. Mm-hmm. But here, they do it a little different, but that's fine.
It makes your hustle better because you're all independent, so everything goes straight to you.
You don't really think radio.
Right?
That ain't which is more authentic music.
It's more commercial shit. It's commercial shit. You know, our main songs is not commercial shit. Our main songs ain't commercial. And that's what our fans in this Bay and this whole West Coast period gravitate towards. You'd be surprised. Like, it'd be songs motherfuckers be asking me about to perform. You know, I'd be like, no.
I ain't never performed that. I never did that.
I get it a lot. I'd be like, damn, maybe I should start. I don't want to perform it. You feel me? But it's just.
I hate when a motherfucker asks me, like, I can deal with the performance songs because you can just throw it in your show and start performing. Yeah. But I hate when motherfuckers want to hear a song or love a song that I've never shot a video to. That's what kills me. Because it really makes me be like, you dismissed the whole band. Mm-hmm. Like, on the real, like, however many times the song is, however many times you have the song on YouTube, all them streams add up. So if you got the regular just song on there with the picture, and you got the video on there too, they're putting both of their streams together. So you feel me? So it's not like they're counting them separate. So it's all together. So you should have did the video too.
Exactly. Yeah. Have you ever come across somebody that was a fan that surprised you? Like somebody that you never, like, oh shit, I didn't know they fucked me like that.
Oh yeah.
I like
that. I remember you told a story one time at the barbershop, I'm not going to repeat it, but you got anybody that you can...
Who was it?
No, it was this famous football player's
No, when I was just locked up this time, when 40 and Show did they versus battle. So you know how, they play NoHo in the middle of it or whatever.
Right.
And in the comments, you know, they had thousands of people watching this shit.
Yeah.
So it was motherfuckers that was surprising. When they played NoHo, people was like,
who was
free D-Lo and, oh, that's my shit. And I'm like, huh? I gotta say this first, because when I was a kid, this was my girlfriend, Kyla Pratt.
Okay. Oh yeah, Kyla fuck with the back tough.
I know that. When I did something to me, I'm like, huh?
Yeah.
I'm like, bro, what nigga, I had her poster.
Hey, he fixed her
on the wall.
Yeah,
nigga.
Kyla fuck with
the back. Like, that's crazy. I liked her when I was hella young, nigga, and she know who I am.
You know who else is a big fan of your music? Chris Brown.
Nah, for sure. I fuck with Chris.
Breezy, really? Breezy, he fuck with your music.
For sure. I was surprised here. I'm surprised then.
He shouted you out on Function.
Yeah, on the remix.
Oh, I forgot about that. He shouted me out.
Fuck else was. It was
somebody else on the Versus comments?
Yeah, it was some motherfuckers. I was just like, damn. Like, but then when I think about it, it's like, nigga, most of these motherfuckers that's saying it, they either live in L.A. or from L.A. You gotta think, out there, they're playing NoHo. You feel me? That was one of my main markets, nigga, in my whole first 8 years of my career. I was like number two outside of the Valley. You feel me? And it was like...
The Valley's your number one market?
Valley, my number one market. Valley.
Sac.
LA and Sac. Yeah, Oakland.
So, okay. We got to get you back out to Modesto.
Oh, I was just there the other night.
Yeah, we got to get you back out to Modesto. You know, Palladium be doing their thing. We got to get you to Mount Moses.
I was supposed to did that, and something happened. I don't know, but and then we ended up doing Palladium.
We were gonna do it, but then the damn pandemic.
So have you ever been burned by a bitch?
Hell yeah, I've been burned.
I've been burned once in my life.
I just told somebody today about it. But I was 18, and this bitch know who she is too. I hope you see this.
Punk
that
bitch.
Little pussy punk was so bitch. Hot.
He said, hey, that shit be warm.
Well, I said, no, listen to what I'm saying. Bitch, you had to been burning for like
a long time.
Because, nigga, I cram at like probably 3 in the morning. Nigga, she leave. Nigga, that morning when I wake up to go take a piss, bro, I swear to God, bro.
That was it off the bat.
No, I'm saying it didn't take long.
Listen, when I start pissing, that shit was
fire. Off the bat.
Fire.
I felt like I was pissing out glass and needles and shit. I didn't want to piss through the whole day. Bitch, I had my shit leaking and all that. I called up, I said, bro. Bro, you need to go to the hospital, my man.
Bro, man, you ain't even babe.
No.
You ain't even babe, no. Bitch.
Listen.
Bro.
Go to the hospital.
Don't sit on anything.
What you talking about, bitch? That cop high.
Don't sit on nothing.
Bro, I was mad. I ain't gonna lie. That was my first time being burnt, so I didn't tell nobody for 2 days. I didn't go straight to the hospital.
You didn't?
No.
You didn't go to the clinic?
I was like, bro, this shit's gonna go away. I'm like, what's wrong with
them antibiotics?
I don't know what is wrong. I'm like, something wrong with
you. Yeah.
Nigga, I did that morning after I pissed, nigga, my drawers got hella
shit in them. Look good.
Cream in
them. Look good. Good job. Look good.
Good job. Nigga, antibiotics, boy.
That should be leaking.
Bro, I went to the hospital. That was the worst part, bro. They took a long ass fucking Q-sip. I don't even know why it was that long. They ain't put the whole motherfucker in there, but they put it
to scare you,
bro.
So you don't get burnt again?
If you say you don't want to do that one, they'll just shoot you in the ass with a shotgun.
Yep.
They should have shot me in the ass.
You gotta tell them you don't want that. Bro. They only give you the ass shot if you say, you ain't doing that.
Yeah.
Bro, I couldn't. I was like, huh? They were like, yeah, we just gotta swab until. I'm like,
yeah.
How this gonna feel?
Bro, that was
long. Because I don't know. But when did I say, oh!
Bro, they brought that motherfucker out. I said, oh no, I said, is there any alternatives? They said, yeah, we can do a
shot in the ass.
Come on, man.
Jaws down.
I bent over like that was shooting steroids in my ass.
Man, ever since then, I be strapped like seatbelts, but sometimes I like to ride without my seatbelt.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But yeah, nah.
That's not that funny.
Cool. I ain't been burnt ever since then. I ain't had no chlamydias, and I don't even know which one that was.
When I was in the military, I had a boy that got burnt 3 times in a row by the same chick. He kept going back to her. Finally, the military was like, if you get burnt again, we're going to get you for destruction of government property. 3 times by the same chick.
Yeah, bitch, yeah. You work for us.
Yeah.
Come on, like taking the pills.
Yeah. He just kept going back to her.
Bro, I only been burnt one time, but after that, every single time I fucked a bitch raw, for like 3 years, I went and got checked blood the next day. Like, that shit had me paranoid as fuck. Like, literally, I'm going to the doctor, like, blood, nothing's wrong with you. Get out of here, man. Yeah. Like, the doctor not
talking. You're like, are you sure?
Let me see.
No, because they can look at your dick without giving you a test and see if they know. Like, they can squeeze it, the pus come out and all. Like, they know. You feel me?
Is
it
a female now?
Yes, it was, but she was older.
I don't give a fuck.
She was all this nigga nasty.
So what's like, next for
you? Even granny's come in handy, nigga.
Oh.
Hey, when I be getting massages and shit, like when I go get a massage, my shit be standing up while I
ain't giving it.
I turn up and keep massage my chest.
You be laying on your back on purpose.
Boy, you can't she do like that. That's
what happened to him?
Yeah.
That's
what happened to him.
Never touched nobody's dick, just got one.
You can't do that.
Yes, sir. Well, I'm not doing that.
No,
you can't.
I'm under the sheet.
No, that's called exposing yourself.
I'm under the sheet. How am I exposed?
The blood. That
what about when they nipples is hard?
Hey, all it takes is for them to feel offended and then they complain.
We get the raw. All
right, Deshaun, watch.
No, you
if you
walk, a lot of niggas are game right now. A lot of niggas don't know this. Be careful what you text to a bitch, because I've just seen so many niggas go to jail for 4 years. This charge right here will give you 4 years. Terrorist threats.
Oh
yeah.
If you text a bitch and say, bitch, I'll beat your ass. Or bitch, I'm finna come fuck you up.
Yeah, that's the one.
Or the number one that every nigga say.
I'll kill you.
Bitch, I kill you.
Yeah.
Ooh, on my kids, nigga, that's 4 years, nigga. If you have a strike, that's 8.
Ooh, I got a strike.
When I just seen
are you listening?
Listen, to the point, I done said that shit so many times. When I was sitting in jail, I said, bro, I'm not finna play with my. I'm like, damn, just think going to jail for selling.
You just scared me.
Look, on some real shit, that's how I was. Think about this. Think about you being a nigga that go to jail for selling dope, drugs, this, that, right? And you tired of going to jail, right? And you like, nigga, I'm not going to jail no more. Like me, I'm on that. I'm never going back to jail, right? You could go to jail not even knowing you gonna finna go to jail. Bitch, I'll kill you. You in your mind, you not thinking, I could go to jail for 4 years for this text message right now.
Yeah.
And guess what? If she was to be like, oh, look, he threatened me to tell the police and they gonna get you, you're gonna be sick. Like, damn. Like, no, I ain't finna go do 4 years for me. I was playing. I was just playing. No.
That's gang right there.
Ooh. Terrorist threat, bro. I seen hella, bro. I swear to God. It's like, nigga, domestic violence now. Everybody's going to jail for a nigga terrorist threats. If that bitch called the police and say, oh, this nigga said he gonna kill me.
Oh yeah, I know.
That's not my
never threatened a woman. Yeah. I have never threatened like me, but I'll say, I'll get your ass beat. Like I'll pay a bitch, you feel me?
But if you say it to her, she has to prove you said it.
Oh, okay.
That's why I said a text message.
Because that's evidence.
Yeah, because somebody could be recording you on the phone talking to them, right? That it's not permissible in court because you have to let the person know you're recording them.
Oh, yeah.
After you let them know you're recording them, everything is fair game after that.
So if you tell somebody, such and such said they're going to beat your ass when they see you, is that?
No, because that's third person.
That's third person.
Okay, because yeah. I be telling
there's no proof of that.
I used to tell bitches.
Yeah, that's third person.
Bitch, I'm going to have bitch, what's the name, sexy?
That's all allegedly, because there's no proof of that.
Yeah, it's all allegedly, but yeah.
Damn. Jail, well, we appreciate that good gang right there. I definitely think about for threatening a bitch ever again.
I'll just be like, all right. You know what's up? I'll put you in cold. Okay.
Yeah, bitch,
I'm gonna throw you a party tonight.
Hey, talking like BBC and shit.
I'm gonna throw you a party tonight.
What
that mean?
Yeah, you'll figure it out. Mm-hmm. So what's next for Vila? What you got coming up? What can your fans look out for or be ready for?
I got a big single off in the drop the beginning of the year. You know, this last quarter shit, you know, should get weird around this time. So I'm dropping my album January, but I got a big single dropping January. I don't want to say who all on it yet, but it's two big artists from California.
California? From up north or down south?
Just one California? One of them from up here, one of them from down south.
Okay.
And I'm just doing hella music right now, bro. Good quality, real, way better D-Lo. It's still the same D-Lo, but just a grown, on my bullshit right now. You feel me?
So take care of business.
Grown D-Lo right now.
Okay.
Niggas,
you giving game instead of running trains.
Yeah, exactly. Appreciate that.
Exactly, bro.
Good looking. Anything else?
Yeah, I got one more for you, but I want to tell me about your CD, bro, because I fuck with Lil Bro. When did y'all niggas realize, bro, like, hey, bro, this rap shit really gonna work for us, bro?
It was actually sleep, so I had no hope. When I first didn't know hope, and when it first started popping, I was in jail. I was in jail all the time. I thought I'd do some time. And yeah, that's just
a surprise.
When I didn't know how, I was out on bail. And I recorded no how and ended up having to turn myself in and do the time. Mm-hmm. And while I'm in there asleep, he was printing out my MySpace page and was sending it to me.
Oh, that's hella dope. So showing
me everything. Yeah, and he like, bro, look, they love you. Niggas hella people holding up free D-Lo signs. And motherfuckers that ain't never even seen me before. Like, you know what I'm saying? I hadn't performed for nobody, did nothing yet. It was just everybody that was playing the song was just like hella on my MySpace page. That was the only way to find D-Lo. Yeah. We wasn't on YouTube or nothing yet. So it was just strictly MySpace. That was the only way to find me. So he was sending me all that when I got out. And I had my first show the day I got out.
Where was it?
Richmond. DJ Slopo took me here. So after that, shout out Slopo. After that, that's when Sleep was like, bro, you gotta really do this shit. It was you, Ben. It was like, nigga, you gotta really do this shit. I'm like,
yeah. This before Sleepy fucking did.
Sleep came with that. When he came with that, I was like, oh, it's on, man.
I remember I'm sitting there because I used to live on 18th and E14. Right in that green gate. That was my spot right there. I had a studio in there and everything. But I remember sitting outside my house right there, smoking a joint in the car. I forgot who I was with, but we smoking in the car. And they played them motherfuckers back to back. They played I'm No Ho, and then they played Sleepy, Fucking D. And I'm like, we already was fucking around at the PTV lab. So I'm like, ooh, they finna go.
Oh, God, we had.
My mom was like, ooh, they finna go.
So we just, we just got on the road together, but we just booking our own shows. I was answering the phone like I was my manager.
Hell yeah.
Answered like he was my manager, or that's just how it went. If I got booked and he didn't get booked, nigga, I was splitting the show money with him still, nigga. Every show, nigga, we was splitting everything.
It was
this is what we do, nigga. It's us, so nigga. Regardless, if I get booked, or if you get booked and I don't, nigga, we both still coming to perform, nigga, for him, because that's what they really want. They just can't afford for both of us.
Yeah.
So, if they can afford one, guess what, nigga? You come do one of your main song, and then, you feel me? That's the time we did.
Hell yeah.
And we just went from there, nigga. Sleep played a big part.
I've never heard no rapper say that. That's the real shit. I've heard rappers just say, I'll do the shit and then just split it, like, you feel me? Just give them just because they there. But I've never heard a nigga be like, listen, it's either me or him. If he get booked, we split it. I get booked, we split it. That's how we was rocking.
That's the real shit I've heard. Because it was D-Lo and Sleepy. Like, that's my real brother. So we did this shit together. Yeah. So it's like, nigga, I'm not going to get paid and you not get paid.
Period.
It don't make sense.
Yeah.
I'd rather a nigga split it. Instead of me giving you, nigga, $500.
It's real brother.
You know what I'm saying? Nigga, it's us. It was D-Lo and Sleepy D. It wasn't just D-Lo, and then he got his little brother Sleepy that rap. No, it was D-Lo and Sleepy D.
And I vouch for that. They did come in together.
Yeah. That's what's up. Anything else you want to leave your fans with?
Just pay attention, man. See, I'm finna drop it on y'all. No homo. The bitches? Yeah, I'm talking about that. But yeah, I'm finna go crazy, bro. I'm working harder than I ever worked. And I'm being real when I say that. I done said that a few times and thought I was. Right now, I'm going crazy, so.
And we for sure gonna have part two of the motherfucking interviews as soon as the album drops. So stay tuned.
Wired In Podcast, I Be The Curse.
We out of here.
Jay Stallone and D-Lo.
Show me.